Hello, my dears. Welcome to another debugging research quest, some of my favorite videos. Now, for some background, I grew up with chronic migraines. I still have them. And I was always told that MSG can be a trigger for migraines and to avoid foods with MSG in them. So I stopped eating fried foods, anything that could potentially involve soy sauce, and started to feel a lot better. And then later on, we realized that I was reacting to a specific gravy that we used a lot in my house. So we started to buy the MSG free version, and then my body was completely fine with it. For validity purposes, by the way, I did not know when the switch happened, and apparently my parents used them interchangeably for a bit, and I only reacted when it wasn't the MSG free one. So it was not any sort of like placebo effect or whatever. And I just like generally figured like, MSG is another thing that I can't eat, just like how some brands of hot dogs are high in nitrates and those also make me sick and other brands of hot dogs don't, and I only know which one is which one after the fact. So I just assumed that MSG was another one of those things. But then in like 2020, with the rise of anti-Asian hate, there were a lot of conversations on social media about how the MSG moral panic was just a straight up racist pseudoscience situation, and based on unbiased modern research, MSG is not actually associated with any of these things, and that we need to actively dispel this myth because MSG is everywhere. This myth disproportionately hurts Asian businesses, and basically if you have an MSG allergy or sensitivity, you're making it up and also kind of using it to be actively racist, so you should just keep that to yourself. And I am all for tearing down the medical industrial complex and pulling apart biased and flawed research to show eugenicist undertones that are always there, and I know that many doctor recommended things don't have much basis in science, they've just been said for generations, so everybody just assumes that they're real. But then if I'm not vaguely allergic to MSG, because that apparently is not a real thing, what am I actually allergic to? Like, is there something else that I should be paying attention to that would, if I figure that out, would help me manage my disabilities better? I don't know. I'm also all for calling out racism, and I very much agree that this myth very much hurts Asian people. We're gonna talk about that shortly, but also the way that many of the conversations about this on social media were phrased, like, if you have this allergy, you're lying about it and you're being deliberately actively racist by saying that you have one, kind of way that made me feel a little bit like maybe there's probably a little bit more of a middle ground than just it's impossible and it is a thing. So that's what we're gonna try to figure out today, and also figure out what the heck am I actually allergic to if it's not MSG? And I sort of have answers, sort of. Also, if you're new here and you're wondering why I'm vaguely qualified to be covering this, hi, my name is Sydney, my pronouns are they, them. I am an openly queer, disabled, autistic, trans, non-binary actor, composer, educator, media analyst, and disability advocate. I'm currently working on a thesis about disability education, media theater, performance, accessible education, basically anything in any and all of those categories, and it is culminating in the world's first all-neurodivergent cast and crew production of The Curious Incident of the Dog in the Nighttime. You can learn all about that and also get tickets, which are free at the links in the description. I also run this channel where I teach you about pretty much anything I learn in all of those categories, including a lot of things where we debunk common yet harmful myths that our professors continuously tell us are absolute truth by going through decades of research and pulling things apart. If videos like that are your jam, I in fact have a playlist of these videos that you can find linked up here and also in the description. Also, I'm a white person in my early 20s with light brown curly shoulder length hair, and I'm wearing a pink floral dress that you can't see, and a maroon cardigan over it, and a necklace, and I'm sitting in front of a bookshelf. Let's start with what the heck is MSG, and then go into where did it come from, where did this myth come from, and is the solution to say it's perfectly safe and that sensitivities aren't real, is that factually a correct take, or is it just a generous overcorrection that might also be harmful? So let's start with what the thing is. So MSG stands for monosodium glutamate. Those sound like big, scary, fancy words, but both sodium and glutamate are super common and also very necessary for physical function. We know that glutamate holds a vital role in functioning metabolism, and sodium is a huge part of blood pressure. This is why people with POTS, for example, like me, are told to eat more salty foods to help our body hold on to blood pressure. Glutamates are also released naturally when cooking or fermenting certain foods, and MSG exists naturally in some yeasts, in tomatoes, mushrooms, cheeses, broths, and most breast milk. It has also been in society as far back as we can remember. The famous ancient fish sauce garum, known as the ketchup of the Roman world, was super high in MSG. MSG basically is that signature savory flavor that we know as umami, and it has been around forever. In 1908, a Japanese chemist named Kikunae Ikeda, I'm sorry if I pronounced that wrong, figured out how to isolate the umami flavor and combined it with sodium to help bring out the umami flavors and turn this into a packageable seasoning. It then became internationally popular and people were putting it on everything, and it was just a great time. Then in 1968, this guy named Dr. Robert Kwok went to a Chinese restaurant, ate a lot of food, drank a little bit too much alcohol, and then was like, wow, I'm feeling sick, particularly with a headache, tingling, heart palpitations, excessive thirst, radiating numbness, and muscle weakness. I'm wondering if maybe it was the monosodium glutamate in the food that I ate or something. Not that I don't know, maybe he was hungover, dehydrated, and ate a lot of really salty food, all of which would presumably cause the same symptoms, but we'll get there. He wrote all of this down in a letter to the editor situation that he sent to the New England Journal of Medicine, who then published it under the title Chinese Restaurant Syndrome. Now, for some cultural context, I guess, this was not peer-reviewed, and it was also not meant to be. So there was a section of the New England Journal of Medicine that was like the doctoral Reddit or Facebook group of the 1960s, which is where doctors would send in prank letters about fake diseases and where doctors would go, hey, I experienced these things and I don't know if it was actually real or not, or if something else might have caused it or what's up, but want to get your opinions on this, and would just put those things in there. But unfortunately, his article did catch on and people started to demand more research into this additive because there hadn't been a lot of testing because it had been around for so long. And like, yes, it's kind of valid, right? We should be testing all the things that we're eating. We should for sure be testing things more than we were back then, but the majority of the cases, it was not like a, oh, we need more food regulation reasoning. It was just fueled by plain racism. Part of why this caught on is because it was the 1960s and 70s, which was a time of a lot of social change, a lot of stick it to the man, and like the big industries are trying to poison us with their unnatural things, and so much xenophobia as well. It was an era of a lot of moral panics, and not that this video relates at all to the troubled teen industry, but that started around the same time frame for other moral panic reasons, so we can see that a lot of moral panics made everything go haywire during this time period. But anyway, thus begins decades of really, really biased and shoddy research into MSG. There were claims that it caused brain damage, nerve damage, obesity, and other bad things that were mostly either anecdotal and sketchy at best, or came from studies that did not at all apply to any real-world scenarios, such as injecting rats with absolutely massive amounts of MSG, and then going, wow, it caused brain damage in the rats. It will do that in humans. Like, who is shooting up MSG? Explain. Anyway, when I was researching, I also found a 2013 book titled It Wasn't Alzheimer's, It Was MSG, which I read some snippets of, and unsurprisingly, I found a lot of pseudoscience. There was this idea for a bit, for a while, since we know that Alzheimer's is often the body creating excess glutamate, that consuming monosodium glutamate caused Alzheimer's. There is no correlation between the glutamate production in the brain and consuming MSG. There was also like the, it's not natural because it's made via industrial fermentation in factories argument. Calcium pills and insulin are also made with similar processes, also in regards to naturalness and processedness and good for you. Tobacco and botulinum toxins are completely natural and very not good for you. So, there's also other research that MSG might actually be a healthier option rather than added fat and sodium. Now, there are many double-blind studies that were done about this where people only reported reactions after they had been told something contained MSG, whether it actually did contain that MSG or not, and it has been generally declared as safe for public consumption. Some scientists theorize that it might be adjacently connected to obesity because savory flavors tend to be more on the slightly addictive side. For example, the powder on Doritos contains a lot of MSG, as does most fast food, which means that you are more likely to consume more of it because we crave that savory taste. But the idea that it messes with your metabolism or whatever has been completely debunked. It is also possible that in some people, MSG could cause headache, tingling, chest pain, heart palpitations, excessive thirst, radiating numbness, drowsiness, muscle weakness, all of those things. But most studies have shown that it only happens with a very small portion of the population and after large amounts of MSG are consumed without any other food, which, yeah, if you haven't eaten anything all day and then you consume a giant bag of Doritos or a big, you know, greasy cheeseburger, you're probably not gonna feel great. That kind of checks out. So are sensitivities real then? That's the next question. When individuals with a suspected sensitivity to MSG are tested in double-blind challenges, the majority do not react to MSG under the conditions of the study or react equally to placebo. Many individuals may therefore incorrectly be ascribing various symptoms to MSG when in fact some other food component may be the cause. In general, a lot of things that are high in MSG tend to be more processed or heavy or fried foods. And this makes sense because these are the things that we think of as savory and salty and delicious and decadent. Those things are not inherently bad. Please do not take this as a discussion of me being like, these things are bad for you and you should be ashamed of eating them and or cut them out of your diet. Like, no, I want to be super, super clear. This is not a discussion of what somebody should or should not put in their body. Diet culture is stupid. It is solely a quest of, why the heck does this thing that it's not possible really to be allergic to make my body mad when statistically and scientifically it shouldn't? Which I'm sharing because I know a lot of people with chronic migraines have similar experiences with MSG and I would love to like debunk some of this research, but I'm not at all being like, processed foods are bad. Please do not think that. I do not want you coming away from this video thinking that. Talking about food gets really sketchy quickly. Just want to acknowledge that. Gonna try not to fall into the sketchy territory, but if I do, apologies. Okay, anyway. For me, I deliberately cut a handful of MSG products out of my life because a doctor told me to. But at the same time, I also started paying attention to what food made my body feel good and what food made my body feel not good. And I stopped eating the things that made my body feel not good. And if I know anything about my body, it's that I'm weirdly sensitive to literally everything. Anything even like remotely artificial is a no for my body. And anything artificial that I've managed to hold on to for this long is also starting to wreak havoc on my body, which is so upsetting because fruit snacks are my number one like mouth stim texture, like safe food, and I'm becoming intolerant to nearly every brand of fruit snacks, and it's very upsetting. But these things, again, are not inherently bad. I am also intolerant to equally as many non-artificial things. I just never liked them in the first place, so it didn't bother me to cut out those things out of my diet, if that makes any sense. Anyway, as I had hypothesized at the beginning of this rabbit hole, it is in all likelihood not the MSG that is the problem. It is the amount of grease and fat and sodium that tends to go along with notoriously MSG-heavy foods that my body cannot handle. And this also includes heavy, greasy, natural things like lasagna as well. Like, thinking about my food palate, as somebody with severe IBS, allergen-friendly Sydney meals are some of the most bland things on the planet. I exclusively eat plain chicken, rice, and vegetables for every single meal at this point in my life because literally everything else makes me sick. And even this is not always guaranteed. Also, my snack foods are equally like bread and tortilla chips and fruit. So, in conclusion to my own small existential crisis, most foods high in MSG are not FODMAP-friendly. MSG itself is technically FODMAP-friendly, but the ingredients that it works best with to bring out those savory flavors typically are not. And if you don't know what FODMAP is, what the diet is, I have a video about it up here. It's a diet for irritable bowel syndrome that is low in certain carbohydrates that have been known to worsen symptoms of IBS in some people. Traditionally, people will go on the diet to heal their gut and then slowly add things back into their diet. Sometimes they can go back to fully normally eating, and sometimes they're me. Still intolerant to absolutely everything, and the list keeps growing as time goes on. I'm just a wonder, aren't I? In regards to the MSG gravy versus the MSG-free gravy, which is my next thing to figure out, I went through the ingredients list of both, and I discovered that the MSG-free one is also gluten and dairy-free, lower sodium, and was produced in their allergen-controlled factory, meaning that traces of other things such as soy, fish, shellfish, wheat, nuts, and other dairy products are not in there. And I am very lactose intolerant and vaguely allergic to soy and maybe shellfish. So there's our answer on that one, case closed. But before we wrap this video up, I do want to talk about something that came up a lot in this research. Some nutritionists and scientists are concerned that all of this recent research has been overcorrecting in the other direction. Rather than go, yeah, MSG exists and it's not going to hurt you, this narrative has tipped over into full, this is amazing and healthy and great for you and you should eat more of it, and become a capitalistic endeavor in another way. In fact, in my research, I discovered a website called msgfacts.com, which is all about debunking this research and talking about how we use it in cooking and whatnot. And to me, that felt a little off and a bit of a red flag, and I couldn't explain why, only to do some extra research and find out. Not even a lot of research. It was very easy to find. The site is run by the Glutamate Association, which describes itself as an association of manufacturers, distributors, and users of glutamic acid and its salts, principally the flavor enhancer monosodium glutamate, for the manufacture and preparation of a wide range of recipes, dishes, and foods. Had I just done preliminary research for this video, I probably would have just gone, oh great, they know what they're doing. I can 100% trust everything they're saying, and left it there. And while everything on their website that I looked at was backed up by other sources that I found elsewhere from various National Food and Drug Administrations around the world, it is important to remind ourselves, right, to look at where our narratives are coming from and who might be benefiting from those narratives. Again, I'm not saying that we should go back to the previous view of MSG. I think there's definitely enough research at this point to prove that it's definitely on the safer side, and the previous narrative is and was very, very harmful. But it is important to realize that just as much as making everything MSG-free became a capitalistic marketing ploy based on misinformation, there is concern that now there might be a new one taking its place, which also could cause harm. There's also the element of some posts that were being like, oh, you're racist if you claim to have an MSG allergy and you're making it up. And yes, everybody is either racist or anti-racist, and that's a discussion for another day. But we should also be careful not to tell people that they're making up symptoms of something that they might be experiencing, because somebody like me could genuinely think that they have an MSG allergy, only to find out they're actually allergic to six other things the whole time, and learn to avoid all those things and feel a lot better. But if we just say like, oh, you're making this up and lying, that person might not take the time to figure out what their symptoms are and where they're coming from and what could be causing them in order to feel better. Like, I understand the point that those posts were trying to make, but we can't fault somebody who is listening to what their doctor told them, made lifestyle changes, and felt better for not knowing the full historical situation of what was going on with MSG, nor should we be encouraging any ideas of people are faking allergies for some other agenda to propagate, because that can cause serious harm to the disabled community, and all of our activism should be interconnected. And I say that as somebody who has loved ones deliberately cook things they're allergic to into meals to try to prove that I've been faking it for attention. I know that it's just a small thing to talk about in regard to this wider issue, but I also wanted to make sure that I put it in this video as well, because that kind of set me off weird. Anyway, as with everything, do whatever makes your body feel the best, because you deserve to feel good. Do the research and find answers for things. That's also important. Critical thinking is great. And I think I've learned something today. I hope that you have as well. And as always, thank you for listening. Thank you for learning. Remember, it's never too late to start over. And I look forward to seeing you right here in the next one.